In the previous lesson, we discussed the first five documents of trade, which is letter of credit, import license, bill of landing, indents, and the policy or certificate of insurance. So our next document is certificate of origin. It is prepared by an exporter, giving details of the goods exported and the name of the country of origin. The name is very important because we have business treaties, we have business agreements. Here we have talked about bilateral and multilateral trade. Bilateral and multilateral trade. And in this case we have business agreements, trade agreements among many countries. So if we have such agreements, like there we have East African Community Business Group that entails countries in East Africa, there are some of the benefits that comes with such agreements. Movement of goods without limitation, we have issues of taxes, we have issues of trading licenses where members from another country can go do business in another country. So such kind of benefits may assist the business people, those are the important exporters, to get some of those benefits. So in this certificate of entry, where we have to give the goods, details of the goods exported and the name of the country, it enables the importer to get preferential treatments on the goods imported. Some of these preferential treatments, we have issues of taxes. Some may have reduced taxes, some may have no taxes completely on the goods imported because of those trade agreements. So if they originate from a country that's a member of a trading bloc, so the trading bloc is those trading partners or the trading countries or the ones that have trading agreements. So for this certificate of origin to work, it must be signed by the relevant authority in the country of origin. So this one must be signed by relevant authority. Must be signed by relevant authority to ascertain that it has come from that particular country, which if it is a member of a trading bloc, they may be charging less or no custom duty. These are the taxes that are levied on the goods that are imported. So certificate of interest of origin is important in some of these countries. Then we have airway bill. As the term says, airway, it's only to those transported by air. Using air transport, use of aeroplanes, and such like. It shows the charges that the importer is supposed to pay the airline company. What you're supposed to pay the airline company, the cost, the total cost of those goods. This one is important. It's not a document of title. It's not like a bill of landing. We'd say in the bill of landing, it's a document of title. It shows who is going to claim the goods. But this one, upon offloading of goods at the airports, upon including those warehouses, it does not show the name of the person who is going to claim. So once you have an airway bill, it's debatable on the title of the goods. You cannot claim the ownership of those goods. What will assist in this one? We have orders, we have invoices that can show what you need to collect from the warehouse where the goods have been kept. Then we have the commercial invoice. This is just like the regular invoice or the normal local invoice that we normally use. And from the definition of invoice, it's just the demand for payment. Basically, all the invoices are used in demanding for payment upon delivery of goods. So this one is the goods should have been delivered to the importer for the goods to be paid for. So it's prepared by the seller to demand payment. The seller in this case is the exporter of the goods to demand payment from the importer. It should contain the name and address of the exporter, the name and address of the importer, the price of the goods, the terms of sale, kulikuwa na discounts or offers or such. But basically here you only talk about discounts. If there had been a discount of the goods, especially on the quantities of goods. Description of the consignment. This one you have to give the name of the goods and the quantities of the goods. So here you have the name and the quantity. Quantity of the goods or the units of the goods that has been transported. Name of the ship transporting the consignment. In every country the ships are named, so it must give specific name of the ship transporting the consignment. So this, once goods have been received by the importer, then the payment can be made. So all the invoices, those are commercial invoice, it's used in demanding for payment. It's sent from the seller to the buyer of the goods. So the seller in this case is the exporter and the buyer is the importer. So those goods has to be paid depending with the price. Whatever that has been quoted on the invoice is what should be paid for. Then we have the next one, consular invoice. The consular invoice, we have embassies in different countries that work as commercial attaches. And we have discussed the functions of commercial attaches in other countries. It shows that the prices charged on the goods are fair, are certified by the importing country's officials. So it talks about the fairness of the prices, or consumed with the embassy in the exporting country. So those are basically our ambassadors in other countries. They have to certify the prices of the goods as being fair. So once it has been certified and the invoices, remember the invoice demands for payment. So once this consumer invoice has been prepared, the copy is sent to the officials of the overseas ports. This one is for the importer. A copy is sent to the officials. This copy, remember that the invoice, it shows the details of the goods, what you have bought, what is transported, and the prices. So the total price and the goods, some of those goods have different tax rates. Others are free of tax, others they have taxes on it. So they're going to calculate the taxes based on this copy that has been sent to the overseas importers, overseas port of destination. So this one, they can assess the import duty by the importing country, and they can easily calculate the total import duty without going through the entire cargo of the goods. So they don't have to go through the examining the details of the goods. If it is in a container, they don't have to open the container and go through the goods one by one to ascertain the value of those goods. So this consular invoice will assist in calculating for the import duty, which will ease in clearing for the goods at the port of entry. So it ensures also speeding up of delivery of goods. So speeding up delivery of goods because of that faster calculation of the import duty. So once the import duty has been paid, then the goods can be picked or taken by the importer. Then we have the pro forma invoice. Like what we discussed in home trip, the pro forma invoice is sent from the seller to the buyer. Once the order has been sent, then its response is the pro forma invoice. It's a marked pro forma and it does not hold the buyer liable for payment of the amount marked on it. It's not a must for the buyer to pay for those goods, but it's always appropriate, given the pro forma invoice, it's a polite way or request of paying for those goods before it is delivered, especially for the new customers. So we have the importance of this pro forma invoice. The first one is to serve as a formal quotation of the goods. This one shows the items and amount. So the quotation of the goods shows the items and the amount that were requested in the order. So from the letter of inquiry, you get the quotation. Once you have the quotation, then you can make an order. So this is a formal quotation because it shows the items still and the amount of those items. The second importance, to serve as a polite request for payment in advance. You pay for the goods in advance. Especially for the new customers who have not developed a good record with the sellers of the goods or with the exporters of the goods. The number three, to enable the importer to initiate clearing of customs duty early enough to avoid delays, like what we've seen under the consular invoice. You can speed up clearing by paying the custom duty. Then we have, it may be used by importer to obtain permission from the central bank to import goods. The pro forma invoice is normally issued before the delivery of the goods. So before the goods are delivered to the port of entry or to the importer's premises, this pro forma invoice can be used in paying for the customs duty and at the same time to get the license. We had said about the importer's license or the trading license to enable you to get the permission to import those particular goods. So that out of the pro forma, we have import license at this point to get the import license, which we had discussed earlier, the meaning of the import license. Then also, this for clearing of customs duty is related to the consular invoice. Then we have the freight notes. It's prepared by the shipping company. And it's also used by the company to indicate the charges for shipping the goods. So here it indicates the charges for shipping the goods. So once we had bill of lading, the importance of the bill of lading. So out of that bill of lading, you know, the goods has reached the docks. We also have free on board. This is one of the terms of sale we had discussed. Free on board. That's paying for the exporter is paying for the expenses to the docks. Then from there, the importer takes up all the charges. So this shows the charges for the shipping of the goods by the shipping company. So once this freight note has been prepared, it means it has to be paid for. So after preparation, the document is forwarded to the exporter, who on payment of the charges gets a receipt. So from this shipping company, This note that shows the charges, the total accumulated charges, it goes to the exporter. Once this exporter pays, they get the receipts, freight receipt notes. Once the exporter has paid, they get the freight receipt notes. Then the exporter forwards the receipted freight notes with the bill of landing and the invoice to the importer. So this one we have the bill of landing. We discussed the importance of the bill of landing and the invoice. We had also discussed the importance of the invoice. So this invoice, it means you have to pay for the payment has been made. We have the bill of landing that shows all the charges that should be from the docks or from the ports of the exporter to the port of destination. So this freight notes, once it has reached the importer, it means the goods can be transported. Once the importer has received these freight notes, the shipping company can transport the goods to where the importer, the port of the importer, and it shows all the other expenses has been catered for. If not, then we have the free on board terms of sale, which is one of the terms of sale international trade. And under this free on board, it is unreceipted. It has not been paid for. So it means the importer has to pay for the goods before it is transported. The importer has to pay for the goods.